welcome to Program Pride. My name is Todd James, and this is our December show. December is a festive time of the year, and whether you're celebrating solstice, Kwanzaa, Hanukkah, Christmas, or whatever, it's the time to get together with friends and family and celebrate the good times and reflect on the past year. On this show, Carolyn Anderson will be talking to some gay fathers in Calgary as well as a PFLAG family. I will be chatting with a lesbian mom about parenting and where she finds support. And rounding out the show is singer Peggy Ward with a festive melody on location in Calgary.
Hi, I'm Carolyn Anderson, and I'm here with Ray Auclair and Glen Hurd, two members of Gay Fathers in Calgary. Can you tell me a little bit about how Gay Fathers started in Calgary?
The history of Gay Fathers is... It's something that was never kept as a matter of record, just for discretion purposes. From what we can gather, the Gay Fathers in Calgary originated sometime in the early 70s. There was quite a few members originally, and then the membership died off, but as of late it's been increasing again through some very positive actions on the membership's part.
Okay, and maybe Ray, you can tell me a little bit about what the purpose of Gay Fathers is. What kinds of activities do they do? What are they involved in?
One of the main purposes of Gay Fathers is to bring together married men, fathers, grandfathers, with children and grandchildren, and get together and share their thoughts on what caused them to break up. Some of these things do enter, but it's an informal evening. Every third Sunday of the month, they meet for a potluck supper, and they share thoughts and ideas, and some people do tell a little bit about their story, their background, and why they came out, and their marriage situation, and the conflicts they have, and some choose not to. It's a choice thing. It's very, very informal. Nobody is pressured into saying things that they don't want to say. There's a lot of discretion, confidentiality. It's really a good time. I think the membership now is up to 30 or 40 people that show up at these meetings, and it's increasing all the time. And it's a nice way to get to meet people with common interests and common situations.
That's a fairly large group for Calgary.
It is.
Maybe each one of you could tell me a little bit about your own circumstances, and then we can look at what drew you to Gay Fathers.
My situation is probably a pretty unique situation. I have an absolutely wonderful wife who's very supportive of me. And actually, when I told her that I was going to be part of this Gay Fathers group, she suggested that I do that. You know, if not for my own personal benefit, maybe I could offer some insight or some direction for other people, and just basic support. So my ex-wife and I are very positive people who want to bring positive direction to our kids' lives and make sure that that there's no misunderstandings as far as bringing up our kids. For me, I go to Gay Fathers for the support, I think, you know, because it's different when you were married and you have kids and you have the responsibilities of a family and everything. It's not the same type of life as if you were never married and then came out. I mean, there's a lot of different issues that you have to face. So it's really interesting to get different perspectives from other people who were in the same situation as you were, you know.
Okay. Thank you. And what about you, Ray?
I've enjoyed Gay Fathers so far. I've got to meet a lot of people that that have the same situations. In fact, some of them have almost identical situations. In my situation, I have older children, 26-year-old son, 30-year-old daughter, and two grandchildren. And it has not been as smooth a ride as Glenn's has the last 2 years when we came out. It has had difficult moments. It's been disheartening at times, but I think I have to accept the fact that everything was a shock to my family, and it's going to take some time to heal. You know, the wounds are deep, and I think they'll come around. I think maturity and the fact that I think the love is still there, you know, family love and family bonding is still there. And I think when you go to Gay Fathers, you see that. You see the comparatives, you see some of them, they do love their children, they know their children love them, but it's taking time. It may take 3 months, 6 months, for some people it may take years. But I think the hope is there that it's, and Gay Fathers is good because you share those ideas with other people, and in a very informal atmosphere with no pressure and a lot of confidentiality.
So it sounds like the group acts as a support group more than
That's
anything.
That's right.
there is a lot of support there, you know, and if you choose to speak, you can speak, and if you choose not to speak and just to listen, then that's fair too, you know. Whether it's a no pressure group, we're basically there to listen, not to offer advice, not to offer any counseling, but to share our own experiences and offer a little bit of support during times that are tough. You know, some of these guys are very emotional. You know, they've gone through some very stressful periods with their wives and their kids, and we're just there to say, hey, you know, we're a group of people that really care about you, and you know, if we can help you out in any way, then that's what we're here for.
What do you think are, say, the three main issues that you find that most of the fathers have to deal with?
What I see is one of the key things is the tug of war between the spouse and the father, and how it's affecting the kids. You know, I know that that there's several different instances that I've heard of where because of the situation, the mother does not want the children to be around the father or their spouse, and it's very stressful on the father, because you know he truly loves his child, and he's searching for a way to come out and be the person that he is inside, and still maintain that fatherly image that's expected of him, okay. You know. So.
And Ray, would you agree? What issues do you think that the men deal with?
One of the, like Glenn has said, the children are so important, but I think they're, as I said before when I was speaking to you, that you have to have a little bit of pain, and you have to go forward with your own convictions. If you are a gay man, and that is the decision you have made, you must go forward, I think, but go slow, and understand that you're. There are children, there are families, there are mothers, there are grandfathers. We've even talked about the fact that there are elderly people that can't deal with it. People that are 75 to 80 years of age in your family, it's a problem for them to deal with. There are certain relatives sometimes you cannot tell. Mm-hmm. And we can appreciate that, because it's just not the right thing, you know. So you have to respect the feelings of everybody in the community, your family, and your workplace. I mean, we've been through the workplace mm-hmm. situation too.
It sounds like Gay Fathers is just a valuable resource yeah. in this community. Just as we close on this interview, maybe you can talk a little bit about what do you hope comes from interviews like this? What's important about speaking out about Gay Fathers?
Well, personally, I think that if we can draw people's attention to the fact that there are some very powerful support groups in the city, that you don't have to be alone, you know, that there always is somebody that's gone through the same situation that you've gone through or you're going through right now, that you can turn to for support. I think that's the key thing that I'd like to see come out of it. You know, like I wish that I would have known that there was places that I could turn to, you know, when I originally came out, but I didn't. So hopefully through a program like you're hosting, we can let people know that, hey, you know, you're not alone, that guys like Raymond and myself and people like you and everybody else that out there are here for support, you know, like we're here to support you and to help you work through your issues, so.
Yeah, I have to agree with Glenn. I think we have to be proud of our organization, of all any organizations. I think too many people relate to the gay movement. It's what they read in the newspaper, in the press, the bar scene, and what have you. Mm-hmm. There's a lot more to gay life than those scenes. The Gay Pride Association, the Gay Pride Parade, the barbecue, all the outings that they've had, the AIDS Awareness Parade that was on as well. Any of these things that can help. And Gay Fathers is just another group. And we know there's three or four more groups around it that will support us.
Yeah. Well, that's great. Thank you so much for your time this evening and for letting people know and just for being there so that people know that there is a place that they can go and that there are supports.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
As we talked about at the beginning of the show, this show is about families. And often we hear stories about parents and families of gay, lesbian, and bisexual people. Today what we're talking about is about being a parent who happens to be gay, lesbian, or bisexual. And today with me on Program Pride, I have Marilyn Clements, who's with the Lesbian Mothers Support Society. Welcome to Program Pride.
Oh, thank you.
I was wondering, Marilyn, if you could tell us a little bit about the history of the Lesbian Mothers Support Society.
It originally started in Toronto. back in the 70s. It was called the Lesbian Mothers Defense Fund. Mm-hmm. And what they were doing is providing support for legal services, legal guidance, and referrals to lawyers for women who were involved in custody battles, who potentially were going to lose custody of their children because of their sexual orientation. And I believe that went on up until sort of the early 80s. And then in 1981, we changed the name of the group to the Lesbian Mums Support Society. And part of the reason for that is women in Alberta especially were not losing their children because of their orientation when they were involved in custody battles. And as far as I know, in the last 10 years, no one in Alberta has lost custody of their children because of lesbian orientation.
Well, that, I mean, I want to say that's encouraging and amazing, but yeah. I also think that should never be an issue.
Well, yeah, a lot of people feel that way, that it should have never been an issue, and now it looks like it's not an issue for many people,
so,
which is great.
You get together once a month, you meet once a month.
Yes,
and,
we do.
We were talking before, and you told me that you can bring your kids or your children too. I think
yeah.
that's great because then there's the interaction with other kids.
Yeah, well, that's part of the support is, you know, if you're a lesbian parent, to, you know, expose your children to other people who are in a similar family situation to yourself. It's kind of nice to know you're not the only one.
And your kid isn't the only one.
Yeah, that's right. And so we usually meet once a month in a very social type situation. We meet at our organizer's home usually. Mm-hmm. Or sometimes we go off to various sites such as the wave pool or the water park. Or
outings.
You know, do outings and stuff like that. Or we also sometimes arrange events where it's just the parents who get together and then the children are doing another activity separate from the parents.
So,
which is nice.
Is Calgary an area right now? How big is the group? Does it vary?
Oh, it varies. Like from meeting to meeting, it will vary. But also, it seems to depend on where people are at in their life. Mm-hmm. You know, like when they have really young children, they're usually trying to make more contacts. And as they get older, that seems to sort of drop off a bit. So the membership fluctuates, you know, quite a bit.
What do lesbian moms as a group do? I mean, is it support, as the name suggests? Is there also referrals?
Oh, well, we provide, like, social interactions through our various events and that. We also provide referrals to, like, gay-positive doctors, lawyers, you know, psychologists or other types of support services that people might need.
Like daycares? And
yeah, and we also provide information, you know, just about how to conduct yourself within the school system and with the daycare situation and stuff like that.
Great. I'm also wondering, because it seems like the whole issue of sexuality is out there a lot more. Is it easier, do you think, to be a lesbian mom today than it was in the past?
I think it is easier to be a lesbian mom today than it was even 10 years ago. Partly because there's more women now with children. and you have groups like the Lesbian Mom Support Society. For women, you know, 10 and 15 years ago, they were like on their own. Mm-hmm. You know, there wasn't really any connected service. And quite often, the idea of a lesbian woman having children was really looked down upon, and it wasn't easy to get the arrangements made.
The arrangements, you mean like artificial
insemination? Yeah, because there's a lot of prejudice against having those fertility services available to women who openly declare themselves as lesbians. Now it's easier to find doctors who will support you in that.
Good. I mean, should be there.
So our organization does provide information about that to prospective moms.
Okay. Has the group made it easier for you?
Yeah, I think so.
Your son?
You know, in the 9 years that I've been in Calgary, this is the group where I feel I fit the most, you know, and I feel that it's, you know, a very positive experience for me and my son.
I'm wondering as well, if today there's a mom who's a lesbian or a lesbian who's thinking about children and she's watching the show, what do you think or what would you say to that woman?
Well, you know, probably, you know, if you want to get in touch with the group in Calgary, you can get information about us through Gay Lines or through Lil or through the QC magazine and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. We also have a page on the web which is kind of neat, and we've got actually had a lot of responses to that. You know, so there's a number of ways that people can, you know, get a hold of us and get information.
Great. Is it worth it to be a mom? I mean,
you're asking someone who already is not one who's thinking about it. So, yeah, I guess, you know, for me, yeah, I guess it is, because having my son has put me into a whole different set of experiences and contacts with people that I wouldn't have had otherwise.
Great. Well, Marilyn, thank you so much for joining us on Program Pride.
It's great to be here.
And sharing with us today.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Carolyn Anderson, and I feel like I'm in the middle of the rainbow room. Everywhere I look in this home, I see freedom flags and rainbow flags and all kinds of wonderful things finally representing something I'm familiar with. I'm sitting here with Deb Bridge and Rick Dickson and Mudgy, or Sir Mudgeon, as I've been introduced. And we're going to talk today about PFLAG and what kind of an organization PFLAG is and what kind of a resource it is for the community. If you could tell me a little bit about what is PFLAG.
Okay. PFLAG is an acronym that stands for Parents, Families, and Friends of Lesbians and Gays. It's an international organization with more than 400 chapters in Canada and the United States, and 11 other countries have affiliates. It was actually started in 1979 by a New York school teacher by the name of Jean Manford, whose son Morty was gay, and he asked her if she would march in the New York City Pride Parade, and she said yes, she would, but she wanted to carry her own sign. She just as a parent. So she carried a sign that year in the parade that said, Parents of Gays, I love my gay child. And that year she was absolutely overwhelmed by gay and lesbian people in and on the sides of the parade who said, oh, I wish my mom would march. And a few years after that, Larry and Adele Starr in Los Angeles had done a lot of work to get the various PFLAG organizations across the United States, mostly then, together, and the organization went national. And at that time it was Parents and Families of Lesbians and Gays. In 1991, PFLAG National Office, which is located in Washington, D.C., added Friends, yes, that's right.
Okay. And Rick, can you tell me what the purpose of PFLAG is?
It's more a support group. There are various members of the group that are going through the different stages right now. We've gone through worrying about our son and how we were going to cope with it and deal with it. We now celebrate our son. And we've passed that point. So what we are trying to do is get the word of PFLAG out there to the people so that they know there is an organization like this that they can turn to for help.
And what kind of help can parents or friends find if they contact PFLAG in Calgary?
Well, as Rick said, PFLAG is largely known as a support group. Its other two purposes, however, are to educate and to advocate on behalf of gays, lesbians, bisexuals, and transgendered people everywhere. But I think the primary thing that PFLAG accomplishes is help parents to accept, initially to accept their gay and lesbian children, and ultimately I would hope to celebrate their children's sexual orientation.
And to let people know that there are other people like them out there who are willing to help them through.
Oh, that sounds like that's really important in this community.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Can you talk a little bit about your circumstances and what it was like for you when your son came and talked to you about being gay?
Well, first of all, he didn't come to us.
Oh. I outed him.
Rick inadvertently outed him.
Oh, and how would that happen?
I found the Playgirl magazines.
Oh, okay.
And asked him, and he said he was gay. And after a brief spout of anger, I figured, well, what's the point? He's the same kid he was 3 hours ago. His sexual orientation makes no difference to me. What I was mostly angry about was the fact that he was six when Deb and I met, so he's grown up with me most of his life, and I was the one who introduced gay couples into the relationship, because my longest lasting friends that I've known for 16 years now are a gay couple. And they were there through thick and thin when none of my heterosexual friends were around, right? So he sort of had them as a role model. They'd need a kid fix every once in a while, and they'd kidnap him. And one of them would do the yard work and the garden work and this type of stuff, and the other one would take him into the kitchen, teach him how to make cookies and donuts and various things like that. So he had a positive role model to grow up with. And it made me angry that even though we were that positive, he was still afraid to come out to us. But he knew it had to happen soon, because things were starting to happen at school, and he knew that he would have to tell us eventually. So it was nice in a way that we did find out and resolved the problem sooner and got on with our lives.
That sounds like an unusual way for a gay child to be able to come out to parents and have parents react. What kinds of things do you find are characteristic of most of the families in the group? Is that a similar, a common experience for them, or?
I think it's hard to say. There are relatively few people in the group right now whose children have come out to them at a relatively young age. We found out about Michael when he was 13. There are a few parents whose kids have come out to them at, you know, 15, 14, 15, 16. And I have...
Some in their early 20s.
Yeah, I have the impression that it was simply something that they never had really considered. And if they had gay people among their friends, they maybe didn't realize that some of their friends were gay. Mm-hmm. But one of the typical responses on the part of many parents is the first thing they do is kind of hit the library. What books are out there, you know? So the educational process for many parents starts almost immediately upon their discovering that they have a gay or lesbian child, no matter whether the child is 13 or 35. And often it's through their reading that they discover mm-hmm. PFLAG, and then from there they'll go through Gay and Lesbian Community Services Association. Is there a PFLAG chapter in Calgary? Or the Pastoral Institute here in Calgary has referred many parents to this particular chapter of PFLAG.
So if there's one thing with this interview as we close, what would you like to get across to people in the community about PFLAG?
That we care not only about the parents, but also about their children. That all are welcome to come to our meetings, to join the group, to participate in any activities that we sponsor or are involved in. And that it's a very accepting and loving group.
Okay. I'd like to thank you both for your time and for creating this wonderful environment for us to come and interview.
Thank you for coming to our home.
Yes.
And welcome to our home.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Peggy Ward. I'm a lesbian singer-songwriter here in Calgary, and I'm looking forward to another fabulous Christmas with my partner and our three children.
Sidewalks, busy sidewalks, dressed in holiday style. In the air there's a feeling of Christmas. Children laughing, people passing, meeting smile after smile. And on every street corner,
For tuning in. We'd like to thank all of our guests for taking the time to be with us today. We'd also like to thank our fabulous Calgary correspondent, Carolyn Anderson. As well, we'd like to thank our cast and crew for volunteering all of the time and energy that goes into producing Program Pride. Over the holidays, you can check us out on the web. We're at gaycanada.com. Stay tuned in most locations for a documentary called The Boy Next Door, which focuses on queer youth in the suburbs of Langley, BC. On behalf of the cast and crew of Program Pride, we'd like to wish you all a festive season and the very best in the new year.
Martadam Renovations, professional design and high quality renovations, serving the community for 5 years. Call Greg or Joan at 276-0099. Flowers by Janice in Edmonton. Check out their new website catalog at worldwideweb.flowers-janice.com. Orlando Books on White Ave in Edmonton. Shop in person or over the internet at orlando@compusmart.ab.ca.